So we have set up all of these required classes as per our current architecture and fetched the data from the property table in our previous video. But at present, we are not fetching the associated data from the master tables. For example, these fields like property type, furnishing type, and city are null that we need to display here on the property list page. Also, at present, we are not fetching the property list on the basis of property type we are passing here. Let's see how to filter the data on the base of specific property type, and also see how to fetch the relational data from the associated master tables in this video. Then we will bind our list page in Angular application to our API endpoint. So go to the property repository where we are fetching the data for properties from the database. To filter the records on the basis of cell rent flag, we can use link extension named where that can filter the data on the base of a filtering condition we provided here as parameter. We can get the reference of DB set here as a parameter. And using the arrow function, we can create the filter on different properties those are available in DB set. So to filter the data on the base of cell rent, we can use p.cellRent equal cell rent that we are getting here as parameter of this method. So now we should get the properties on the base of cell rent flag. Yep, we are getting a property where cell rent equal 1. And if we change it to 2, perfect, we are getting the property where cell rent equal 2. And in case we pass the ID other than 1 or 2, as it is not available in the database, we are getting this blank array. And the beauty of the entity framework is that this filtering is not performed in the memory. Instead, our SQL queries are created in that way only. That this filtered search is performed at the database level using where clause. If you want to check how the SQL queries are generated at the backend using entity framework, you can use SQL profiler. And if we try to call any method on API using Postman, you can see the query here in profiler that is sent by the entity framework on SQL. So the entity framework is sending the cell rent flag in the where clause of SQL. That means at DB level, we are fetching only the required data. It is not like that we are fetching a complete data of all the properties, either it belongs to the cell or rent, and then it is being filtered at API level. So entity framework most of the time creates optimized query. Sometimes we need to tweak a few things for optimization purpose. I will tell you some of those cases further in this tutorial when we will work on performance tuning and optimization of this application. So next we will fetch the data related to our navigation properties. We are getting the foreign key ID here, but the entity framework does not load the related navigation properties by default. And in order to get the associated navigation property, entity framework provides us include extension method, and we can tell here which navigation property we need to include in our DB set. Let's include the property type. So in this way, we are telling our entity framework to perform a SQL join between these two tables, property and property types, on the base of primary and foreign key relationship. And if now we will try to call this API endpoint, you can see a property type is also included as another JSON node in API response. And if we look at the SQL profiler at the backend level, entity framework will create a query like this using inner join. And if you are already working on SQL database for a long time, you must be aware that joins are used in SQL to join the two tables on the base of a relational key. So here entity framework automatically created an inner join for us between these two tables to fetch the data from another table. So similarly, like this, we can include multiple navigation properties in the chain, add city as well, and also add furnishing type as well. And if now we will try to call this endpoint, Yep, we get all the required data in our DB set that we need to display here on the list page. But as discussed in our previous videos as well, it is not good to directly expose our domain entities. And also it is not worth populating all of these fields like last updated by, last updated on, etc. To our client. We are overexposing here if we will do that. So to avoid these problems, we can add the DTO for this property list that will expose only the fields required to display on the property list page. So go to the DTO folder and add a new class. Let's name it property list DTO and add the required fields here. So these are the fields I have added in property list DTO. Now we can use this DTO in our property controller. We will return the DTO here instead of returning our domain object. So next we need to map our domain object to DTO. We will use AutoMapper service to map our domain object to DTO. So inject the IMapper service here in the constructor. Let's name it mapper and import the required namespace. Now we can map the DTO using this service. Let's take a local variable, property list DTO for this mapping and set it to mapper.map. And we need to tell a type of destination object that we would like to map from our source object. As our destination should be the list of object, let's pass an IEnumerable of objects. Here object would be property list DTO. And the source would be the property list that we are getting here in this variable. But this mapping will not work until we create a map in AutoMapper profile. If you remember, we already have created this map for the city object. These profiles are created here in the helpers folder in the AutoMapper profile class. For city mapping, it was very simple because there was no difference in the names between source and destination fields. So it was as simple to map just the source object and destination object here in the create map method like this. But this time that is not the case. Few of our fields are different than the source. For example, we are getting complex object in property type, furnishing type and city here. But in our DTO, we have defined these fields as string. And we would like to map only the name property out of this complex object for each destination field. This is something new that we have not done previously in this tutorial. Let's see how to map such properties using AutoMapper next. So first we will create map and tell what is the source and what is the destination that we would like to create a map for. And then for those fields where name or type is different between source and destination, we can create custom mapping for individual fields using for member method. And here as first parameter, we need to tell the destination field. So for example, here we need to create a custom mapping for the city field. We can get the destination object here as parameter and using the arrow function, set it to city. And in the second parameter, we need to tell the source that is to be mapped to the destination. Here we get the member option as parameter in this function, and it provides us a method called map from. And in this method, we can get the source object here as parameter that we can use to map as per our requirement. So here we need to map the name property of city to the city property of our DTO. We will select city.name. So now we can return the property list DTO here in our controller and see if our custom map is working or not for the city field. Yep, we have successfully mapped the city name to our DTO using a custom map. So our custom mapping is working fine. Let's define the custom map for these other fields like property type, furnishing type and country as well. save it and let's try to call this endpoint again. Perfect, we are getting all fields required for property list page. Next, we can use this API endpoint in our Angular service and populate the data of this list page from API. But before calling this API endpoint in our Angular service, we need to update the Angular model that we are using to bind the property card. If you look at the Angular model, we are using this iProperty base to bind the property card and compare it with the API response. Here are few things that we would like to handle. You can see we have changed the name of a few fields in our DTO. So in order to get this map automatically as per our API response, we need to change the same in our Angular model as well. Another problem will happen that even if we change these three properties as per our DTO, then also our list page will not be populated. And the reason is by default our API endpoint returns the fields in camel case notation. But in our Angular model, we are not using the camel case notation. So we'll have to update the Angular model to follow the camel case notation for all the properties. Let's go ahead and make these changes first. And as we are referencing this model in many TypeScript file in our Angular application, it would be tedious to replace the reference in all the places manually. Hope you would already be aware that VS Code provides us a way to rename a field or property name in all places in one go. We can place the cursor on the property that we would like to rename and press the F2 here. And then we can rename it here. In that way, all the references where this property is being used will automatically be changed. Let's rename it in this way for all the properties to match with our DTO. So all are renamed. Let's check the same in property class where we are implementing this iProperty base. Yep, these properties are automatically changed here as well. And I am not renaming other properties for the moment, but eventually we will have to rename these as well. But let's take baby step and just focus on the fields that we are using on the property list page for the moment. So this automatic renaming using F2 works perfectly in the TypeScript files in VS Code. But it does not automatically rename the references in HTML file of the component. If we look at the HTML file of the property card component, you can see the name of reference properties are not renamed here. VS Code is showing error here. And these red blocks tells us that there is some error in our code at a specific location. And as soon as you will start to fix these errors, these red blocks will start to disappear from the sidebar here. So all red blocks are removed. That means we are good for this page now. Let's save it. Similarly, we will have to update the reference fields in property detail component as well. And finally, change the same in add property component as well. So now we are good to call our API endpoint in housing service. At present, we are calling our static data file here to get all properties. Let's remove this code and call our API endpoint here using this .http.get and also specify the response this API endpoint should return, and it should return an array of property and pass the URL of API. Use this .base URL to get the base URL and concatenate the endpoint specific to get the property. So our URL is property /type, and we need to pass the cellrent flag here as parameter that we are getting from this method. So concatenate the same here as well. And I just realized it would make more sense if we change it here from type to list. Means this endpoint will return the list of property, and after that we can pass the parameter that what type of property we would like to get from the database. Add a slash here as well. Let's rename this endpoint in our controller as well, from the type to list. So we have made all the required changes to populate the list page from API endpoint. Let's run the Angular application. Yep, it is compiled successfully. Let's open the same in browser. Perfect. Our list page is now populating this property from our database. And if we press rent, we are getting a different property from the database. And if we are pressing buy button, we are getting the different one. We have not set anything for the image for now. That is why we are getting the default image here. And if we click on the detailed view, it is not working. Let's check in the console and see what error we are getting. And we are getting error cannot read property to string of undefined. And the source to look up is here. The final trace is showing two methods here. We are getting this error on get all properties on line number 32 that is being called from the get property method from line number 23. Let's open this file housing.service. And here on line number 32, we are using this toString method that is showing error. And on clicking the view detail link, this method is being called. And here when we are calling get all properties, we are not sending any parameter here. And before binding this method to the API, this cellrent flag was optional here. And we were returning all the properties if we were not passing this parameter. But now this is not the case. This cellrent flag is now important to pass in our API method to get the list of properties associated with the specific type. So let's for the time being pass hard-coded value here and see if it works. Yep, now this detail page is loaded. But as our API endpoint is not returning all the fields and we are returning only fields that are important for the property card, we are not getting any value here in the detail view. Next, we will fix this issue. We will add one more endpoint to get the property detail, to get the detail of single property instead of returning a list of properties. And then we will update this detail view component to populate all the fields here that we get from the API response. So see you in the next video. Stay tuned. Bye-bye.